Good evening. We hope all you moms had a great Mother's Day. Thank you for coming tonight. Let's stand and sing praises to God. I believe in a hill called Mount Calvary. There were things as we travel this earth-shifting sands that transcends all the reason of man. But the things that matter the most in this world, they can never be held in our hand. I believe in a hill called Mount Calvary. I'll believe whatever the cost. And when time has surrendered and earth is no more, I'll still cling to that old rugged cross. I believe that the Christ who was slain on that cross has the power to change life today. For he changed me completely, a new life is mine. That is why by the cross I will stay. I believe in a hill called Mount Calvary. I'll believe whatever the cost. And when time has surrendered and earth is no more, I'll still cling to that old rugged cross. I believe that this life with its great mysteries surely someday will come to an end. But faith will conquer the darkness and death and will lead me at last to my friend. I believe in a hill called Mount Calvary. I'll believe whatever the cost. And when time has surrendered and earth is no more, I'll still cling to that old rugged cross.
You love the Lord tonight? Amen. Amen. Good to see y'all tonight. Happy Mother's Day once again. And I hope you mothers got spoiled today. And I tried to talk these kids into washing the dishes and folding the clothes and all that. And if they didn't do it today, they said they were going to make sure and do it the rest of the week. So that was the deal that they made. Anyways, thank y'all for being here tonight. Hope y'all had a wonderful day. And I'm looking forward to spending some time in God's Word with you tonight. And then after the service, I'm going to ask for your help, those of you that are able to. They are supposed to start the new carpet tomorrow. And so we're going to take these chairs, those of you that are able. And we're just going to move these chairs right next door to the fellowship hall. And if you're able to help, that would be great. If not, that's fine. But and then Lord willing, we'll be back in here on Sunday. I'm not sure about Wednesday yet, but we'll just pray about it and see what happens. And so let me go ahead and pray for us, and I'll ask God's blessing upon our service. Father, thank you, Lord, for the hill called Calvary that we just sang about. Thank you for the old rugged cross. Thank you, Lord, that you have changed me, as the song said, and given me a new life completely. Thank you, Lord, for what we have in you, and I pray, God, that we'll be reminded of that even tonight. Thank you for this time to gather here, and I pray that you bless our services. I pray that you speak to our hearts. I pray that you just cause us to rejoice as brothers and sisters in Christ. And I pray, God, that you just move us closer to you. And I pray that you bless our song service. Pray that you bless our preaching. And then I pray, God, that you just bless the rest of our evening. And I pray, God, that you use us this week for your glory. In Jesus' name, amen.
What a day that will be. There is coming a day when no heartache shall come, no more clouds in the sky, no more tears to dim the eye. All is peace forevermore on that happy golden shore. What a day, glorious day that will be. What a day that will be when my Jesus I shall see, and I look upon his face, the one who saved me by his grace. When he takes me by the hand and leads me through the promised land, what a day, glorious day that will be. There'll be no sorrow there, no more burdens to bear, no more sickness, no pain, no more parting over there. And forever I will be with the one who died for me. What a day, glorious day that will be. What a day that will be when my Jesus I shall see, and I look upon his face, the one who saved me by his grace. When he takes me by the hand and leads me through the promised land, what a day, glorious day that will be. Thank you. You may be seated.
Amen. That's one of my favorite songs, I believe. What do you look forward to most about heaven besides seeing the Lord? What do you look forward to the most? Yes, sir, Brother Bostick.
A new body.
Amen. Amen. Miss Cindy, what'd you say?
No goodbyes.
No goodbyes. Amen. Who else? What do you look forward to most? See your loved ones already up there laying your gifts at the Lord's feet. No more sickness and pain. Amen. No more parting over there, like you said, Miss Cindy. Anyone else? What's that? What do you say?
Food.
It's going to be heavenly, won't it? We'll all be thin. Amen. I guess we won't need to exercise, amen. So, amen. What'd you say, Brother Bostick? Amen, amen. We got a lot to look forward to, and if you're saved, we got a lot to look forward to. Well, amen. Just want to remind you, this Saturday we'll have our next ladies fellowship here at the church at 9:15. Ladies, if you're able to make that, if you wouldn't mind bringing your favorite breakfast or brunch item, and a copy of the recipe, if you don't mind sharing that. If it's a family secret from a long time ago and you don't want to share it, we'll buy it from you. Anyways, that's next Saturday. I didn't say how much. but that's next Saturday, 9:15. And then after that, we'll have our next community outreach. And and then next Sunday, we'll have our graduation Sunday. And I just want to honor our graduates, and so looking forward to that. And so that's next Sunday. And then the Memorial Day church cookout, I'm looking forward to that again. Last year was a great time. And that is Sunday, May the 29th, right after the morning service. We'll have little park passes. So if you don't have a park pass, we'll give you a little ticket, and that will take care of you getting in there. And we have a pavilion rented, and so we'll just cook out and hang out and play some games, maybe sing some songs, we'll see. And then we'll have our afternoon service and just hang out for a while. So that is Sunday, May the 29th. There is a sign-up sheet out there in the foyer if you want to bring something to that. And then also there's a sign-up sheet for the ladies' fellowship. out there. And then there's a sign-up sheet out there for the Ark. And Noah and his whole family will be there. And so that's out there if you want to. His family's on a boat trip. You must have been the one that put that then.
a boat
or a ship?
You're on a boat,
we'll be on a ship. Okay. So that is out there as well. And we're hoping to take, I know several people are interested or mentioned that, so we're looking forward to that trip as well. And then there's also some information out there if you're a teenager or you know a teenager that is interested in coming to our camp this year for the summer. And then we'll probably start talking about VBS pretty soon because VBS will be right around the corner. And then we'll also have, I'll be talking about a revival soon. We're having a revival that's right around the corner as well. So a lot to look forward to. And if you do not have a church calendar, those are out there if you want to grab one of those. Last time I said that, I think we had about 10, and those 10 all went. So it's a blessing when folks take those things. And then, as I mentioned, Lord willing, we're planning on starting on the carpet tomorrow. And so they'll be here, and they think they can get it done in 5 or 6 days. So that's what we're hoping. And if not, that's fine. But we're going to try to move the chairs next door. And then if you haven't seen the building next door, not the fellowship hall, but next door, the education building, they're making some good progress back there as well. So we're praising the Lord for everything that's getting done, and we're just excited about what he's doing and what he wants to do. And I believe until the Lord comes back and gets us, he has something for us to do. And we just want to be faithful and good stewards of what he's given to us. Well, let me go ahead with all that being said and pray for our offering. Just want to remind you, Rebecca has her surgery in the morning. Is that right? Let's pray for Rebecca in the morning. She's going at 5:30. Is that what I heard?
Yes, she's here at 5:30, yes.
Okay. So let's pray for Rebecca and her surgery tomorrow. Still praying for Miss Jean. Good to see you today. Been praying for you. And so lots of things on the prayer list. I'm just kind of looking through here really quickly. Obviously, I know we pray for our country a lot, but our country's pretty divided right now. And our country needs a lot of prayer, and none of this is taking God by surprise. In last days, perilous times will come. And men are lovers of themselves more than lovers of God, lovers of pleasure more than lovers of God. And sin is a real thing. Satan is a real thing. But God's still on the throne, and we know how the whole thing ends. But let's just be who we need to be, and let's just ask God to help righteousness prevail. And obviously, you know, as long as we're here, we pray for our country and pray for people to get saved and pray for God's help. And we want everybody to know the joy of, you know, living for the Lord. And so let's just pray for our country and pray for what's going on overseas as well. Let me go ahead and pray. We'll pray for our offering, and we'll pray for these things as well. Father, I do pray for Rebecca and her surgery in the morning. I do pray, God, that that would go well, and that you would, Lord, just guide every move that the doctors make and every just thing that they do. I pray that you'll just allow everything to go well, and I pray, God, that you would heal her body and allow her to not have any more pain or discomfort. I pray, God, that you continue to be with Miss Jean and her health. And I pray, God, that you just continue to heal her body. And Lord, just the other many folks that we have on our prayer sheet, I pray for them as well. I pray for, Lord, our country. I pray for what's going on in Ukraine. And I just pray for the needs there. And then, Lord, I just pray that you'll bless our offering and bless the rest of our service. In Jesus' name, amen.
You can remain seated for this one as we prepare our hearts for the evening message. Allow the Spirit to speak to you as we sing this Spirit of the Living God.
Spirit of the Living God, fall fresh on me. Spirit of the Living God, fall fresh on me. Break me, melt me, mold me, fill me. Spirit of the Living God, fall fresh on me. Spirit of the Living God, fall fresh on me. Spirit of the Living God, fall fresh on me. Break me, melt me, mold me, fill me. Spirit of the Living God, fall fresh on me.
Amen.
Amen. Would you take your Bibles tonight and turn to Mark chapter 6? Thank you, Brother Phil. Thank you, Miss Rita. Mark chapter 6. We pick up tonight where we left off last week. It had been a busy day for Jesus. If you remember, as soon as they crossed the Sea of Galilee, the disciples had come and reported how their missions trip had went. And after they finished, Jesus said, you need to come apart before you come apart. And so they got on the ship. And they went over the Sea of Galilee. And the people saw them get on the ship. And they ran and met Jesus and the disciples over there. And when Jesus got off the ship, he saw the multitudes, and the Bible said that he had compassion on them. He said they were as sheep having no shepherd. And he began to teach them. He taught them many things. And as the day drew to a close, the disciples came to Jesus and said, Jesus, it's probably best that you go ahead and dismiss the service now. You've been preaching too long. And it's getting late, and the people are probably getting hungry. It's probably time to send the people home. We're in the middle of nowhere, and we don't have any food to eat. Well, if you remember the story from last week, Jesus had other ideas. And instead, he told the disciples, he says, I want you to give them some food to eat. And the disciples said, with what? And Jesus said, well, go ahead and go see what we have, see what you can find, see what you can come up with. And how many of you ladies have ever said that? Let me go to the kitchen and see what I can come up with. And so they went, and among all those people, they found one little lad that brought his lunch. And he had 5 pieces of bread and 2 fish. And they came back and reported to Jesus what they had. And Jesus took the bread and took the food and blessed it and broke the bread and gave it to the disciples. And they gave it to the people. I remember when I was in college, I think my junior year, I was home for the summer, and I was working to pay for my college tuition. I remember in the mornings I would lay flooring, and then in the afternoons I would sometimes sell newspapers, and if I wasn't selling newspapers, then I was working at IHOP, and I was serving tables. And I remember serving tables. If you had 5 or 6 or 7 tables, you just felt like overwhelmed, and this guy needs another Sprite, and this guy needs another lemonade, and this lady wants her check, and this guy's not happy with his food, and and this person wants more napkins, and this person wants ketchup, and I'm just saying all that because we need to pray for our servers. And so I just remember, man, you just set me another table. I don't want another table. But I can't imagine serving 5,000 people. Here Jesus is, and he told these, how many disciples did he have? He said to make them sit down in 50s and hundreds, and then he blessed the bread, he broke it, and then he handed it out to the disciples, and he said, go feed these people. And the Bible says last week that they all ate and they were full. And in verse 43, they took up 12 baskets full of fragments and of the fish. They ended up with more than they started. They started with five pieces of bread and two fish. They ended up with 12 baskets full. Wonder why they ended up with 12 baskets full. I know people have their thoughts. I don't know. 12 disciples. Maybe they were about to take it on the trip with them, and maybe it could have served as a reminder. And we'll see that here in just a moment. But after they finished gathering the food, Jesus had gathered the food and so forth, and he told the disciples to get on a ship and go over to the other side because he was going to send the people away. And that's what we're going to pick up tonight in Mark chapter 6, beginning in verse 45. And the Bible says this, and straightway, I don't think I've mentioned this yet as we've been talking through the book of Mark, but Mark is an author that he's just, he kind of gives you the quick picture. He just kind of goes quickly through it and straightway or immediately. He's one of those fast-paced people. And so he says, and straightway he constrained his disciples to get into the ship and to go to the other side before unto Bethsaida while he sent away the people. And when he had sent them away, he departed into a mountain to pray. I'm just telling you, when you get there, friend, when you can find that time, it's a wonderful thing. And when evening was come, the ship was in the midst of the sea, and he alone on the land. And he saw them toiling and rowing, for the wind was contrary unto them. And about the fourth watch of the night, he cometh unto them, walking upon the sea, and would have passed by them. But when they saw him walking upon the sea, they supposed it had been a spirit, and cried out. For they all saw him, and were troubled. And immediately he talked with them, and saith unto them, be of good cheer, it is I, be not afraid. And he went up unto them into the ship, and the wind ceased, and they were sore amazed in themselves beyond measure, and wondered. For they considered not the miracle of the loaves, for their heart was hardened. And when they had passed over, they came over into the land of Gennesaret and drew to the shore. Most of us are familiar with this story. There are several miracles, several, I think, very captivating miracles that took place this evening on this ship and so forth. And I want to look at those miracles in just a moment. But before we look at the miracles, I want to draw your attention to the Lord Jesus Christ for a few moments. And I want to point out a couple things about our Savior. And you've probably noticed them before. But the Bible says this in verse 46. And when he had sent them away, he departed into a mountain to pray. Let's pray. Father, I do pray that you would help me now as I speak. And I pray that you would help me to be a blessing and a help to our church. I pray that you would, your Spirit would speak to us, and that you would help us, Lord, with whatever we need and whatever way we need help. And I just pray, God, that you'll add your blessing to the reading of your word tonight. In Jesus' name, amen. I want to notice three things with you this evening. And the first thing that I want you to notice about Jesus is this. Number one, his personal time with the Father. His personal time with the Father. The Bible basically says that night had descended and the last voice had died away, and Jesus had sent his disciples away, and Jesus had sent the multitude away, and when they were all gone, he departed into a mountain to pray. And although he was probably tired, you ever get tired from a long day? And although he was probably tired from his long day, he did not miss his
necessary quiet time alone with God. And although he was probably busy, he was no doubt busy. He was in the middle of his ministry, and the people were always wanting to see him do something. He did not miss his necessary quiet time alone with God. Scripture does not record here for us what Jesus prayed for, but if you look in the different accounts of this story, it basically just says that Jesus prayed into the night. As I think about what Jesus might have prayed for, I can imagine that he probably prayed for direction in his ministry. He probably prayed for direction as to what was going on and what the Father wanted. John 6:15 tells us that after they saw Jesus do the miracle of breaking the bread and feeding the 5,000, the Bible says that the people tried to take Jesus and they wanted to make him their king right then. And so, I mean, obviously, if you were just in a crowd and you saw somebody all of a sudden take that food and break it and they feed the whole crowd, I mean, that would seem like a pretty special, miraculous, amazing person to you too, right? And so they wanted to make him the king, and Jesus knew that the time had not come for that, but one day he's going to come and he's going to rule and reign as king on this earth. And so the Bible says that he sent his men away. He didn't want his men getting any thoughts. I mean, here's his closest circle. Here's his disciples. And you know how maybe we can naturally feel. Here's Jesus and look at what he's doing. And you know what, Jesus, maybe you should set up your kingdom. And here's his right-hand men and they can kind of be his inner circle and so forth. But the Bible says he sent them away. I imagine he prayed about the direction of his ministry, but I also imagine that he prayed for the disciples and their maturation, because he knew what they were about to go into. You see, they were going into a storm, and he knew that they were going into a storm. And so I believe that he prayed for them while they were in their storm. It's humbling if you think about it for a little while, of the fact that Jesus Christ prays for us. He prays for us. Hebrews 7:25 says, "Wherefore he is able also to save them to the uttermost that come unto God by him, seeing that he ever liveth to make intercession for them." You see, Jesus knew the disciples were going into a storm, but he wanted his disciples to grow and to mature in their faith, just like he wants us to grow and mature in our faith. You see, he knew that they would have storms later in life, and this could be a teaching moment. You know, I don't want to miss the opportunities or the things that the Lord allows to come into my life, because it may be a teaching moment. You know, if I'm not careful, you can kind of just shrug it off and it's just another day and it's just another this or just another that. But do you ever think that God allows things to happen in our lives because he wants to teach us some things? And so I think this is a teaching moment for these disciples. The psalmist said this, friend. He said, "Before I was afflicted, I went astray. But now have I kept thy word." You see, sometimes storms do for us what prosperous times will not. They often push us to our knees. Now, of course, God would rather us pray in both stressful times and successful times, but sometimes it takes the stressful times to bring us to our knees. Here Jesus is, though, at a very high point in his ministry, and here he is at a very successful point in his ministry, and the Bible says he prayed. He still had his time alone with his Father. I just want to think on this thought of prayer for a minute. The Bible says this: in everything, give thanks. The Bible says this: pray without ceasing. The Bible says this: be careful for nothing, but in everything by prayer and supplication. Let me tell you what I think God's saying. I think he wants us to pray. The Bible says this in Luke chapter 18, men ought to always pray and not to faint. We should pray for our food, and we should pray for our families, and we should pray for our friends, and we should pray for our finances, and we should pray for our future, and we should pray for our freedoms, and we should pray for our fears, and we should pray for our faith, and we should pray for forgiveness, and we should pray for a whole lot of things. In fact, we should pray for everything. The perfect Son of God thought it was necessary to have personal time with the Father. We should too. He sent the people away so he could be alone with God. People sometimes get in the way of our time alone with God. There may be a time where we have to send people away because, hey, my time alone with God is important. Now, I know we don't want to be rude because these people can actually see us. Well, God can actually see us too. And so he sent the people away because he wanted to have personal time alone with God. No people, no phone, no distractions, just you and God. When's the last time you had that? When's the last time you had that? Sometimes I read my Bible on here, but very seldom do I read my Bible on here. You know why? Calls, texts, news, whatever else. And here I am in my quiet time alone with God, and this becomes a distraction. Now, you might be able to handle it better than me. That's probably true. But I'm just saying, when's the last time that you just really, I have to turn my phone off, I have to send the people on, whatever the case may be, because my quiet time alone with God is that important. It was that important to Jesus. First thing I want to notice about Jesus tonight is his quiet, his personal time with the Father. And when evening was come, in verse 47, the ship was in the midst of the sea, and he alone on the land. Number one, his personal time with the Father. Would you look at verse 48, the Bible says this. And when he saw them toiling in rowing, for the wind was contrary. You ever feel like the wind is contrary to you? You ever just feel like life is difficult? And about the fourth watch of the night, he cometh unto them. Maybe about 3 or so in the morning, walking upon the sea, and would have passed by them. Second thing I would like to draw your attention to tonight is this. Number two, his personal interest in the disciples. His personal interest in the disciples. Even though Jesus here is occupied with matters of eternity, he was still interested in the needs of the disciples. And he's still interested in the needs of the people in this church as well. The Bible says this, he saw them toiling. You see, what happened to the disciples in Mark chapter 6 was not happenstance or circumstance. It was not incidental or coincidental. It was providential. It was something that God knew would happen. You see, the Lord Jesus Christ told the disciples to get onto the ship. And he knew the storm was coming. Can I say this tonight? In the Bible, we read about different kinds of storms. I believe we read about correcting storms and perfecting storms. Correcting storms and perfecting storms. You remember a man by the name of Jonah? Jonah was running from God, and so he was on that ship to Tarshish, and there was a storm, and he convinced the men to throw him overboard, and he was swallowed up by a great fish, and he was running from God. He was out of the will of God, and so God sent a correcting storm into his life. But if you read this passage of Scripture, the disciples were not out of the will of God. They were right where God told them to be. You see, I think they were in a perfecting storm. They were in a storm where God wanted to grow them, where God wanted to teach them. And so the disciples are here in this storm, and Jesus sees them. He sees them toiling, so the Bible says, while they're in the midst of the sea, he saw them. Can I say this, friend? While you're in the midst of the sea or in the midst of your storm, he sees you as well. If you study the distance here, most commentators think that they were probably miles away. Can I say this? Distance makes no difference to the Lord. We may not always see him, but he always sees us. The Bible also says this. It was about the fourth watch of the night. Can I say this? Darkness cannot conceal us from the Savior either. He sees us even in our darkest days. Verse 48, once again, the Bible says this, and he saw them toiling in rowing. For the wind was contrary unto them, and about the fourth watch of the night, he cometh unto them walking upon the sea. In other words, they weren't left to struggle alone. In other words, he was willing to meet them where they were at. In other words, he was interested in their survival and their growth during the storm. You see, this storm that looked like it was going to be over their heads was under his feet. This storm that looked like it was going to overwhelm them, Jesus was literally walking on the waves. He was a wave walker, as I heard a preacher preach one time. He was literally walking. He was using the waves, the vehicle that terrified his disciples so much. He was using that as a vehicle to get to them. Think about that thought. Which leads us to our next point. Number one is what? His personal time with the Father. Number two is what? His personal interest in the disciples. Number three is this: his powerful influence over creation. His powerful influence over creation. This is where most of the time we think about the story. The Bible says that the wind was contrary and he was walking upon the sea and would have passed by them. But when they saw him walking upon the sea, they supposed it had been a spirit and cried out, for they all saw him and were troubled. And immediately he talked with them and saith unto them, be of good cheer, it is I. Be not afraid. The first thing that I want to notice tonight about his powerful influence over creation is this. Number one, he walks on water. He walks on water. That's not an easy feat, by the way. Not only does he walk on water, he can allow others to walk on water. Now, he hasn't allowed me to do that yet, but if he wants to, he can. I have a question. This is confession time. How many of you have tried to walk on water? Not as many as I thought. How many of y'all didn't raise your hand the first time and you have? Okay. I just thought everybody tried to walk on water.
I just read it in the Bible and I thought, okay, I want to try. But it didn't work.
But if he wants to, Mr. Reed, he can allow me to walk on water. Mark does not record this story, but here is the same occasion where Peter walks on water as well. And so not only does he walk on water, not only does he allow others to walk on water, but he also controls the storms. The Bible says this in verse 51, and he went up unto them into the ship, and the wind ceased. And they were sore amazed in themselves beyond measure and wondered. The idea is this: the disciples were beside themselves. There's just no way. He literally turned off the storm again. You ever turn off a water spigot? It's like Jesus just turned off the storm just immediately, and it was off. They were sore amazed in themselves beyond measure. They could not believe it, and they wondered. He controls the storms. But not only does he control the storms, this is an interesting thought, he controls time and space. He controls time and space. If you write this reference down, John chapter 6, verse 21, the Bible says this way, then they willingly received him into the ship, and immediately the ship was at the land whither they went. Where were they when Jesus met them? They were in the middle. And when he got on board, immediately they were on land and the storm stopped. You see, one moment they're in the midst of a raging sea. The next moment they're on a calm sea at their destination. Why? Because he's in control of time and space. You see, Jesus constrained his disciples to get on the boat and go over to the other side. I want to notice something with you. Jesus did not say get on the ship or get on the boat and go under. He said get on the ship or get on the boat and go over. Okay? So he told them they were going to go over. God had a plan for them and God has a plan for us. Someone once said that the grace of God will never take us where the grace of God cannot keep us. You see, God has not promised us smooth sailing. If I were to entitle my message, here's what it would be tonight. He has promised us a safe landing, though. A safe landing. He's not promised us smooth sailing. But he's promised us a safe landing. He said, not go under, but go over. If God says that we're going to get to the other side, you're going to get to the other side. And can I say this? Even if a storm gets in the way, even if a few storms get in the way, when the disciples received Jesus into the ship, they were immediately at the shore. Can I say this? Their destiny was already determined. Our destiny is already determined in a sense. Time and space are not impediments unto the Lord Jesus Christ. If he says we're going to get to the shore, he's going to see us to the shore. Andrew Murray said this, God is willing to assume the full responsibility for the life that is totally yielded to him. He is willing to assume full responsibility for the life that is totally yielded to him. We all have a free will. But God told the disciples, Jesus told the disciples to get on the ship, and they were going to go over to the other side. If God tells you to do something, friend, just do it.
Amen.
Just do it. And he'll take full responsibility for whatever he told you. God, I don't see how this is going to work out. It's not looking good. He'll take full responsibility for what he tells you to do.
Right.
And by the way, he's able to make sure everything works out just like he said he would.
Yeah.
Here, these disciples are toiling, and Jesus gets on board. And as soon as he gets on board, the storm stops. They're marvel. It's beyond comprehension to them. And immediately, they make it to the other side. They had a safe landing. They had a safe landing. The Lord Jesus Christ, friend, he comes to these disciples after his time alone with the Father. And after his time alone with the Father, he shows his personal interest in the disciples. And after he shows his personal interest in the disciples, then we see his powerful influence over creation. I want to close with this thought. As God's people, when we spend personal time with the Father, God does something to us.
Right.
He changes us. He gives us new desires. He gives us new interests. And we too, like the Lord, will have an interest in the disciples. We too, like the Lord, will have an interest in other people. We'll have an interest in the work of God. I'll just be honest with you. I have no interest greater than the work of God. I don't. And so as we spend this personal time with the Father, he changes us. Our desires become his desires. And then when we are changed and we start taking interest in the things that he's interested in, we start to see God working. And I'm not saying he's going to make us walk on the water. That would be pretty cool. But God's still in the miracle working business. And we can still see some other miracles done. But it's not going to happen if we're not spending time in God's word.
Right.
We talked about it this morning. Faith comes one way. Comes by what?
Hearing
by the word of God, yes. And we have to be students of the word. We've been talking about this a lot on Wednesday night. False teachers. How do you know if you're not in there? I don't know when your quiet time alone with God is. I just pray that you have it. And I believe if we have a church full of people that have quiet time alone with God, we're going to view people differently. And we're going to see God work in ways that we never would have imagined. That's just how God works. He's willing to take full responsibility for a life that's completely yielded to him. Father, thank you for your word tonight. Thank you for the example that you show us in your word about you and the Lord Jesus, having your personal time together. Thank you for what you show us in your word, that you are interested in the disciples and likewise you are interested in us. I don't know, Lord, perhaps somebody here tonight feels like you're not interested in them. I pray that you would remind them that you are. And then, Lord, I thank you for reminding us that whatever storm may come, you're still able to take care of us. You're still able to give us a safe landing. I pray, God, whether right now we're in a correcting storm or a perfecting storm, that we would learn the lessons that you have for us, and we would trust you along the way. Thank you for your word tonight. Every head bowed and every eye closed, I'm just going to ask the piano to begin to play just for a moment. And I just want to give you a time, just a few moments, if you would just spend some time just talking with the Lord. Maybe you've been missing your quiet time. Maybe you haven't had your quiet time with the Lord as faithfully as you once did. Maybe you want to get back to it. Maybe you've never had it and you want to start. Maybe you say, Lord, I'm too busy with other things and other people that I just kind of let you go to the side. Jesus had to send the people away. He had to make time, personal time with the Father. I believe when we spend time with the Father, he does something for us and to us. When we're walking with God, I believe God's going to show us some miraculous things. I believe that with all my heart. I love this place. I love that we get to serve God here together. Let's keep growing together. I want y'all to get in the ship and go over to the other side. Why did Jesus allow them to do that? He knew it was going to happen, friend. It was a perfecting storm. Have thine own way, Lord. Father, we thank you so much for your word tonight. I thank you, Lord, for the encouragement that it's been to me. And I thank you, Lord, just for the thoughts that we've shared. And I just pray, God, that we'll take your word to heart tonight and we'll allow it to be something that we think on and meditate upon and trust and grow thereby. Thank you for the good day in your house. Thank you for just a good service this morning and the good crowd and the visitors. Thank you for the folks tonight, and thank you just for the sweet place you've given to us. And God, I just pray that you would help us with all the many things that we have on the calendar in the coming days and weeks. And I pray, God, that you give us wisdom. And I pray, God, if you speak to us about something, that we'll just be quick to listen and ready to respond. Thank you again, Lord. We love you in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, all hearts clear tonight. Amen. Brother Virgil, you staying out of trouble? Trying. Is your daughter staying out of trouble? You think so? Amen. Kids, you did a fantastic job today. Thank you so much. I was so excited, and just appreciate our young people. You guys are a blessing, and I hope maybe we can do that more often. You guys are very, very sweet young people and very talented young people. Raised on loving Jesus, amen. Best way to be raised. And so thank you, Miss Rita, for being a blessing tonight, Brother Phil. And our stream team back there. Got some three new folks in training back there. And they did a good job today, didn't they? And so praise the Lord for a church that just loves the Lord and is willing to serve. And well, let me be quiet, and I'll close this in prayer. And if you're able to help, only if you're able to help. If you're not able to help, please don't feel pressured. We never want you to feel pressured. But we're going to prop that door open and stack those chairs next door. I do want to say this. All of the back rows, I believe,
have different chairs. So you're like, they don't look different, Pastor Josh. You got to look at the back of them. So the back of them, they do not have places to put the cards, the visitor cards, the envelopes, the pens and so forth. So if we could stack those chairs separately, that way when we put them back, they're not all mixed up together. And so we can just put all those in the back when we put them back in here. Sorry. And other than that, I don't really think I have any other. Does anybody have any questions about that? Huh? Choir chairs, we can just stack them however. I do not know if we will be in here on Wednesday. I'm praying that we will be if they can get all this done. They're supposed to try to tackle this first. If not, we'll just have services in the fellowship hall like we do, and we have our afternoon services. And how many of you, I'm just asking again, how many of you like the afternoon services? Would you raise your hand? I mean, like, really, really like them. Okay? Just praying about that, and maybe we'll take a month or so coming up and just try the whole month and see how it works out, see what y'all think. And just tell us what you think. If you think no, Pastor Josh, but with gas at 409, it should be helpful too. Amen. And just saving time, and plus the fellowship. And I just, every time I do it, people say that they like it. So anyways, praying about that. And I think that's it for now. There's a couple sign-up sheets out there if you're interested. Am I forgetting anything? Can anybody think of? Yes, sir, Brother Bostic. Oh, Brother, go ahead, Brother Bostic.
Are you going to leave the books and the receipt?
I think that they'll probably be fine. If you just carry the chairs right, that because we have some other ones stacked next door and the books are still in there and they stayed in there fine. But if we have problems with them, we'll take them out. But I think this should be okay. Thank you. Brother Bob, were you asking the same thing? Great minds think alike.
Amen.
Amen. Brother James, were you going to ask the same thing?
No,
you just wanted to be in that club, didn't you?
No,
okay, me too. Anyone else? Piano. Yeah, I was thinking about when they got to that, I was going to try to call six or so guys and see if we can move it when they, because what, so for those of you that don't know, we're going with the tiles, and so once they, hopefully they'll start down here, once they get the tiles down, we'll just move it down there and set it on the tiles, and then they can do this, and we'll just move it right back. That's kind of what we were thinking. So if I call you at like 3:00 in the morning, that's probably what it's for. He'll be awake anyways. He's always up. What time do you go to work? 3:30 or 4 every morning. So that's when he's up praying for you, just so y'all know. And anyways, thank you. That's another good question. Any other questions? Any other questions? Please pray for Rebecca tomorrow. And anyone else? All right. Let me pray for us. Father, thank you for your word again. Thank you for the good day. I pray, God, you'll dismiss us with your blessing and your presence and use us this week, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. You are dismissed.